preached that Sunday. So I said, okay, I'll be there.
I became a member because of several events that took place. First of all, I had moved to the neighborhood, and after moving to the neighborhood, we realized that we needed a church home. So my wife and I and our children, Maurice and Sheila, we needed them to have a place to study and study the Word of God and feel comfortable. So we had been visiting different churches, and then we saw this church at 7505 South Polk Street, and we decided to go in, and we met the pastor and everything, and he was real friendly, and it just seemed like that was the place for us to be. So that was Reverend Robert L. Castle III. So he just became a member basically because of him and his love that he showed toward us.
So the first Sunday in February 1982, I came back to Friendship West to preach, and unbeknownst to all of us, Reverend Castle had walking pneumonia, and he passed that week.
On February 25th, 1982, Friendship West would face its first major trial with the untimely death of the founding pastor, Reverend Castle.
Before he passed on, we used to have chats. We used to have conversations after Bible study. And one of the things he said to me was that, he said, you know, one of these days I'm going to go out to Bishop College and get one of them preachers out there, bring him over here, and let him preach for us, and then I'm going to go on home and be with the Lord. And it's amazing how that happened, because Pastor Haynes' father knew Pastor Castle, and because they knew each other, you know, he just went out to Bishop College and was researching different people. And by him being an alumni of Bishop College, you know, he just felt like that's what he needed to do.
On February the 13th, 1983, Reverend Haynes assumed pastoral leadership at Friendship West and was officially installed as pastor on April the 10th, 1983.
So I get a call from Deacon Wilson, who was chair of deacons at the time, and he said, you know, our pastor just passed, and we need a preacher for Sunday. Would you mind preaching? And so I said, okay. And so that Sunday I preached, felt really bad. And after church, they asked me to serve as interim pastor.
And I came to Friendship West. My husband had been a deacon for years here at this church. One of the first deacons were Deacon Miles and Deacon Thomas. I was at another church, St. Philip Missionary Baptist Church, where I was engaged in a lot of activities. So it took me quite a few years to make my mind up about coming here. And I kept hearing so much about Dr. Frederick Haynes, the young man who came to this church at the age of 21 from Bishop College. I said, what's going on over there? My husband said, you got to hear. And so I've counted it all joy.
So that's the beginning of, you know, the relationship with, you know, Freddie Haynes and Friendship West. It was just a trip. Let me say this right quick, because I got to know Pastor Castle, which I had no idea. 1975, he's talking about organizing a church that I'm gonna end up preaching for and pastoring. You know, God is something. And then on top of that, that July of 81, when I preached for him, he picked me up Monday, took me to lunch, give my honorarium and stuff, but we had a long talk about what he wanted to do with Friendship West. And I hate to say it, but I'm in church, so I can't lie. I was so uninterested. Number one, because I had had a bad experience preaching-wise to me. And he's telling me about how the church loves me. And I'm like, no. And then he starts telling me about, well, this is what I'm going to do. We got 8 acres of land. We're going to build out here. He's talking about being a church involved in the community. He said, you know, we were one of the first black churches in Oak Cliff when black people started moving to Oak Cliff. He said there was Concord. Bailey starts Concord. Tony Evans started Oak Cliff Bible Fellowship. And then there's Friendship West and Eastgate. He said, we were the four who really started things here. And so I'm like, okay, that's nice. And he said, but I got a vision of acreage. That's why I got these 8 acres. And we're gonna you know, do this and do this and do this. And he had these big plans.
Friendship West. Come on now. I said good morning, Friendship West. This is the day the Lord has made, and let us rejoice and be glad in it. Aren't you glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? He woke you up and he stirred you on your way, put you in your car and brought you to here today. You ought to give him a hand clap of praise. Amen. Well, my name is Aaliyah Early, and I am part of the Chosen Generation Youth Ministry. And I'm here today to give you a word of prayer. But before we do, I would like to say hello to all of our visitors in the house and online. If you are online, make sure you hit that follow button. Make sure you subscribe and turn your post notifications so you never miss a wonderful word from this church. Make sure you hit that like button and share with others around you and with you so that they can also get this wonderful word. Now, if you do not mind, please join me in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you. We just thank you for bringing us through another week that was not promised to us. We thank you for keeping everyone safe. We thank you for keeping us together, composed. We thank you for letting us come into your house and show you what we have for you today, oh God. We thank you for every person in this room right now because we know they are a living testimony, oh God. We know that they have a purpose here. And we know that they will use their purpose in life to do good for you. We pray for the word today, pray that it will move somebody, pray that it will help somebody who just does not know yet that that word is for them, oh God. We pray for every staff member in here who has been doing their job and doing their purpose for you, oh God. We pray for every living soul here today. We thank you for bringing them in, oh God. We thank you for everything that you're doing, everything you're about to do, and everything that you will do, oh God. We just thank you for all these things. And in Jesus' name, I do pray. May it be lived by your word. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Jesus is. Now give another great praise for your great God. Now come on, worship the Lord like you know who Jesus is. I said worship the Lord like you know who Jesus is. Like you know him as a heart fixer and like you know him as a mind regulator. Anybody know him to be a healer? Somebody else knows him to be a company keeper. Come on, bread when you're hungry. Water when you're thirsty. A bridge over troubled waters. And then they testified he's love and then peace. Anybody know him to be joy? That's just who Jesus is. Come on, testify. Testify to somebody. That's just who he is. Come on, turn to somebody and tell them that's just who he is. That's just who he is. That's just his character. That's just his quality. That's just his kind. That's just who Jesus is. Faithful friend. Come on, faithful friend. Strong tower. Mighty redeemer. A buckler and a bulwark. Come on, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run therein and are made to be saved. You ought to just give God praise for being who he is. Come on, not for what he's done. Because if he doesn't do anything else, he's already done enough. But you ought to just worship him for being good and kind and faithful and perfect and never failing. That's just who Jesus is. Oh, you ought to give God worship in this place. I said give God praise in this house for who and what he is. Ain't he all right? I said, ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? That's just who he is. Shout yes. Come on, shout yes. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, God. For who and what you are. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Go to your seat with a praise. Go to your seat with a praise. We honor the Spirit of Christ. It's in him that we live and move and have our being. This is the day that the Lord has made. We got a duty and a responsibility to rejoice and to be glad in it. If you're watching us online, you hear that sudden sound of worship, that sound of praise. It's because God is good, but it's also because we're excited that you are here with us. So shout out to the online audience. You could have been anywhere in the world, but you're kicking it with us. Do me a favor, hit that like button, hit the share button, share your expressions of greeting and love in the comment section. Matter of fact, y'all ought to come in online greeting one another in the spirit of the Lord. And again, we are super delighted and excited that you are here with us this morning. The same goes for those of you who are visiting with us. If you're a visitor, we just want to look at you. Just stand on your feet real quick. We're not going to ask you to say nothing, but we just want to honor you, celebrate you. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my sister. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you for being with us today. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. You may be seated, but we thank God for you and your presence with us today. On behalf of our senior pastor, Dr. Haynes, and the entire household of faith known as Friendship West, we thank God for you, that God ordered what your steps and your stops so that you could be with us in worship this morning. If you have a church home, we send you back with our greatest blessings as you journey back to your church home. But if you are church homeless, as we say at Friendship West, you can end your search for a church. You can end your quest right here at Friendship West, because we ain't got nothing but love for you. I love when they do that. We ain't got nothing but love for you. And so we give God praise for you. If you're a visitor with us and you want to learn more about our ministry, want to learn more about what God is up to in the life of Friendship West and the ministry of Dr. Haynes, our discipleship ministry wants to connect with you. You can do that by texting FWVIZ to 28950. That's FWVIZ to 28950. Our discipleship ministry would love to hear from you and would love to serve you. Come on, give God praise one more time for those who are in our midst, who are visiting with us today. And y'all just look good. Give God praise for yourself. You're looking good and strong and healthy and beautiful. We give God praise for each and every one of you. And I want to inform you about, we got a lot of exciting things that are coming up in the life of our church. We are excited for you to hear about it, especially this Wednesday at 7 o'clock p.m. Somebody shout Vision Night. Shout it again real strong. Shout Vision Night. And we're excited about vision. Why? Because we know that without a vision, the people perish. But we give God praise that God has given us a vision and that he's given us a visionary in the person of our senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Frederick Douglass Haynes III. We're going to be sharing in Vision Night this Wednesday, January 31st, 7 o'clock p.m. here in the main sanctuary. You don't want to miss it. You're going to have an opportunity again to hear the vision for 2024 as it will be laid out by Dr. Haynes. But you'll also have an opportunity to hear from our pastoral staff, ministry leaders, lay members of our congregation as we talk about what it means to move beyond the year of excellence. It's not that we're getting rid of excellence. We're going to take it with us, amen, as we walk into 2024 knowing that we are what called toward a greater purpose. Every one of us, each and every one of us, has something that God has called us to, something that God is calling us toward and for. The question is, are you going to answer the phone? Amen. We know that we are called toward a greater purpose in 2024, and so we want to encourage you to be with us in Vision Night. And we've been moving toward it. Pastor's been teaching and preaching from Ephesians chapter 4, talking about your calling, talking about your purpose, what God is doing in your life. And we're going to culminate that experience in Vision Night. Also excited that we have in our midst a president. Amen. Come on, give God praise that we get to celebrate our senior pastor this week, who's going to be installed as the president. I can't hear nobody of the Rainbow Push Coalition. We give God praise for Martin King. We give God praise for Jesse Jackson. But we also exalt the Lord that our pastor, that the angel of this house, is being elevated to a new level. And we thank God that the mantle that rested upon them rests upon our senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Frederick Douglass Haynes III. Come on, give God praise in this house. We honor the man of God. We thank you all for your overwhelming response to attend Dr. Haynes' installation ceremony as president and CEO of the Rainbow Push Coalition this Thursday and the Social Justice Conference that is scheduled for this Friday. The installation event is sold out. Somebody say sold out. It's sold out and at capacity. And so the request that is being made is that if you have tickets that you RSVP for, but we're no longer be using, please let us know so that we can then bless someone else to attend and be a part of this historic event and this historic occasion. Let the church say, that means you're going to be obedient to that. Amen. If there are other tickets that become available, if there are additional tickets that are available, they're going to be released today. Somebody say today at 6 o'clock p.m. And then again on Monday at 6 o'clock p.m. They will be first come, first serve via the Eventbrite page only. Unfortunately, we are not able to hold any tickets. There is limited capacity for this and for the Justice Conference on Friday, February the 2nd at Paul Quinn College. If you have not registered for that conference, I need you, ma'am. I need you, sir, online or in the sanctuary, to register today for what is going to be an historic occasion. We give God praise, amen, one more time for our senior pastor and what God is up to in the world through the life and the ministry of Reverend Dr. Frederick Douglass Haynes III. Now, I need you to do me something real. I need you to do me a major favor. I need you to give God praise for this youth choir, this Selah youth choir. That's getting ready to come. Come on, give God praise for them as they come. Come on, bless us, y'all. Thank you.
That's why I can't be without you. Won't let say, oh, 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 I need you. Make it real big, like the music, and say, say, oh.
The Pastor McGrew in me.
I need. Yeah, can we sing that? Every hour, I need thee. Oh, oh, bless me now, my
God with me for our wonderful children, our young people, Selah. They have blessed us today. Today they've done that. Hallelujah. Shall we pray? God, thank you so much for being God and being so good that you meet our needs. Thank you that you supply all of our needs according to your riches in glory. Thank you for being such a need-meeting God. God, we testify now, we pray, we need you. Yes, we need you. Every hour we need you. Now bless us now, our Savior. We come to thee in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. I want to call your attention in these few moments to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4, if you were here last Sunday or tuned in last Sunday, you know, I didn't finish. And so this is part two of what we started last Sunday, part two. And so we, in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, and he gave the apostles, the prophets, and evangelists, the shepherds and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up
the body of Christ, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. You've been set up for your come up, part two. You've been set up for your come up, part two. Lauryn Hill, absolutely brilliant, raises the question, where is the passion in this living? Are you sure it's God you serve and obligated to a system getting less than you deserving? Lauryn Hill, prophetically insightful, as she indicts a system determined to repress, oppress, and suppress us. And then she challenges us to check our own personal passion as well as our relationship with God. And then raises the question about our own complicity in a system that we feel obligated to serve, giving us less than we deserve. If you're not careful, it can happen in this thing called life, where you can get so caught up in your living that you become blind to a system giving you less than you deserve. And Lauryn says, if you're blind to a system giving you less than you deserve, you need to check the passion in your living and the God that you are serving. I like that. Because the question I'm raising right now, I've seen before, I'm sure you have, and that is, are you in a real sense making things happen, or are you watching things happen, or will you wake up one day and wonder what had happened? I'm raising that question because oftentimes the relentless problems of life and the insufferable situations we find ourselves in that stress us and depress us can cause us, if we are not careful, to become blind to what's around us. And before you know it, we sideline ourselves because life is just too much. Listen, I'm not judging you. Lauryn is not judging you. I'm simply saying that if you're not careful in this thing called life, too much life can happen. And when life goes to life, and before you know it, you will find yourself sidelined instead of being in the game attempting to make a difference. I'm not coming through. I'll make it real plain. This is, of course, toward the end of the NFL season. I flash back to 1998 when the Denver Broncos, led by Terrell Davis, they were playing the Green Bay Packers in the Super Bowl. And what is interesting is that Terrell Davis had spent his life dreaming of playing in a Super Bowl, but Terrell Davis, the morning of the Super Bowl, had forgotten to take his preventative migraine meds. Now, Terrell Davis suffers from migraines, and those of you who know anything about migraines know that they can be debilitating, severely painful. And that morning, Terrell Davis, my sisters and brothers, forgot to take his preventative medication. 15 minutes before the game, before kickoff, he has a flashback that says, I got to take my meds. He rushes to take them. By now, it's too late. Terrell Davis takes the field, and when he takes the field and runs with the ball, the knee of an opponent for the Packers hits him on the helmet. It triggers the migraine. Watch it. The trauma from the impact, it triggered, as it were, severe pain. And now, as a consequence, Terrell Davis says the migraine sets in When it sets in, his vision is blurred. He cannot see anything. And then what happens? He takes himself out of the game. I understand that, because don't miss what happened. He is sidelined because of his personal suffering. Don't miss what happened. He has dreamt of playing in the Super Bowl, but his worst nightmare comes true at the wrong time. I think I've got some metaphors to work with right here that will get in your Kool-Aid and call out your flavor, because already I pulled into somebody's address, because the bottom line is, you've been there where you have dreamt of something happening, and just as it is about to come to pass, everything falls apart in a nightmarish-like fashion. Wait, I'm not done. Terrell Davis is sidelined by suffering. How many of you would like to do more, but your own personal plight, problems, and predicament keep getting in your way, and as a consequence, what you thought you would be doing, you are not doing, because you were sidelined by your own suffering. Wait, I got to give it to you like this, because for Terrell Davis, the worst thing happened at the worst time. Have you ever had that happen in your life? You have been getting ready for this to take place, and the next thing you know, just as things are about to work out, everything falls apart. The phone rings and you discover that someone in your family has been stricken with an illness, or worse than that, the phone rings and what you had been praying would not happen has actually happened. I'm letting you know, all of that will cause you to be sidelined. And here's what's a trip. He's sidelined during the Super Bowl. Wait, I gotta stop right there, because my sisters and brothers, this is the biggest game of his life. It's the biggest stage that he will play on, and now he is sidelined. Well, my sisters and brothers, I've simply come by to let you know the stakes are high and times are hard, to use the language of De La Soul, and the question is, are you going to be sidelined by suffering? Are you going, watch this, to allow the nightmare to squash your dreams? Are you going to allow the worst thing happening at the worst possible time to blind you to the good that God may be up to, even in the midst of what you're going through? Well, I'm not coming through, so let me hop homiletically into this passage and note with me that the writer of the book of Ephesians, of course, we have discovered that though it is ascribed to Paul, that scholars have suggested that in light of the language, that it's not Paul but a protege of Paul who has adopted the identity of Paul in order to share a message, an enlightening epistle to the Ephesian Christians. And the Bible lets us know that he shares this moving message, and in this moving message, I've quoted her all month, Mitzi Smith, the wonderful womanist biblical scholar, says it's really a legal document merging two corporate entities, one foreign and domestic. And my sisters and brothers, in conversation with the brilliant Mitzi Smith, it hit me that if this is a merger, a legal document merging two entities, one foreign and domestic, then the objective of this book, watch this, is to attack the sin of social hierarchy. I gotta stop right there, because social hierarchy is indeed a sin. And even though chapter 5 has some problematic passages in it that reinforce social hierarchy that have been used against us and against women in the past, I want to suggest that chapter 5 runs
runs in contradistinction to the total theme of the book of Ephesians. And so here, my sisters and brothers, is this Ephesian writer trying to bring people together. But here is what is interesting. In chapter 4, at the very beginning, which signals, watch this, a new movement in the book, chapters 1 through 3, were chapters that dealt with doctrine or theology. Now, chapter 4, he says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, park right there parenthetically, because he is using, as it were, the prison predicament of the gospel globetrotter and trailblazing theologian from Tarsus. He is adopting the identity of Paul, but also the situation of Paul. Paul in prison, don't miss this, sidelined by injustice. That can happen. Injustice will sideline you. But here is the shout I'm trying to get to. Even though he is sidelined by injustice, this becomes a part of what has been labeled the prison epistles. In that, watch this, somehow God is able to squeeze a blessing out of what is squeezing us. To use the language of the late Manuel Scott Sr., God is so wonderfully good that when life negatively puts the squeeze on you, it squeezes something positively out of you. And before you know it, what others intended for evil, God transforms it into something good. But it all begins with your perspective. Note what the writer says. I therefore, a prisoner of the Lord. Not Caesar, but the Lord. Not Rome, but the Lord. Because in this life, your perspective can power your performance in the midst of your predicament. You better preach, Freddie Haynes. In a real sense, in this thing called life, it's not what happens to you, but how you look at what happens to you. And so what the writer does, the writer says, I'm not a prisoner of Rome. I'm a freed captive of the Christ. And because I'm a freed captive of the Christ, I've been put in prison, but my message is going viral. I think I'll park right there because y'all missed your shout. They have prison epistles that we never would have received had a prison, had injustice not taken place. Well, y'all think that's just back then. It even happens right now. Y'all do know in a real sense that much of the literature and scripture that is so powerful came from a dark place. It came from captivity. It came from a dark dungeon. And y'all, God can let you go viral when folk are vicious to you. If you don't believe it, ask my sister Gina Stewart. This past week, my sisters and brothers, National Baptist Convention got together for what should have been a historic gathering in Memphis, Tennessee. And my sisters and brothers, sadly, instead of being historic, they had to act prehistoric and archaic. Because my sisters and brothers, y'all don't know what happened, I'll let you know. Four Black Baptist conventions that had split in the past came together. We got four different Black Baptist conventions. Ain't that a trip at the time when Black folk need to be together more than ever? You got a convention here, a convention there, here a convention, there a convention, everywhere a convention. Because it's all about powerless people trying to have power that they really don't have. Well, my sisters and brothers, the conventions gathered in Memphis, Tennessee, and against the objection of the National Baptist Convention, USA Incorporated President Jerry Young from Jackson, Mississippi, first of all, he objected to me preaching in the session and said that their convention would pull out if Frederick Haynes was on to preach. And my sisters and brothers, I said, cool in the gang, I got bigger platforms every Sunday when I come to Friendship West. And then
My sisters and brothers, Gina Stewart was invited to preach. He threatened to pull out again, but the brethren, we said, no, we ain't coming to Memphis and not hearing from the baddest preacher in the land. We are coming to Memphis and Gina's going to preach. Do you know that he and his ilk, they boycotted Tuesday morning and did not show up when she preached? But y'all know that didn't stop the Holy Ghost from showing up. You see, I've discovered other folk can walk out, but that's when God shows up. And y'all, Gina Stewart preached the horns off of Billy Goat. Gina Stewart preached until the heavens opened. Gina Stewart preached until the Spirit of God moved. And y'all should have seen those white Jesus in blackface preachers sitting there on her, upset that she was preaching. And y'all, it hit me that that's what the problem is, that the Black Baptist Church needs a fresh history lesson. Why are we Black Baptists and not Southern Baptists? Why are we not American Baptists? It's because the Black Baptist Church was born in resistance against the tyranny of social hierarchy. And yet when we were born in the 18th and 19th centuries, beginning in Georgia and South Carolina in the late 1700s, Black Baptists in resistance to white Baptists, white Jesus, formed their own churches, and we formed them because we were anti-social hierarchy, and as a consequence, we began a legacy of liberating sisters and brothers from Nanny Helen Burroughs to Prathia Hall to Rosa to Martin Luther King Jr., William Augustus Jones, and Charles G. Adams, all of them liberating forces. But somehow in the 20th century, Black Baptists adopted the theology and hermeneutic of white Jesus. Now, I can't understand why Black Baptists would get with white Jesus, knowing that white Jesus has been hell on black people. White Jesus, first of all, let's be real, is a lie. White Jesus was created in the image and likeness of white supremacy in order to engage in the sin of social hierarchy. And so, my sisters and brothers, that is what has been adopted by the Black Baptist Church. And I'm simply saying to my beloved brothers, I got to call you out to bring you in, because the bottom line is, what do you need? What are you missing, my brother, where you feel that somehow you can use the Bible to make women second class? Why would you do that? That's what was done to us. Why would you do that to our own? Because of your own need to feel more of a man. I've discovered when you are secure in your manhood, you know that nothing is taken from you when you lift up sisters. As a matter of fact, you can't really respect sisters as a queen unless you see yourself as a king. And so I'm simply saying, my beloved brothers, quit using the Bible to justify your misogyny. Quit using the Bible to justify sexism. Quit using the Bible to hold women down, because you can't hold somebody down without getting down in the hole with them. And so I'm calling Black Baptists back to our resistance roots. I'm calling back Black Baptists back to our liberation roots. Please, for the love of God, be delivered from white Jesus. And let's go with the Jesus who had hair like wool. Let's go with the Jesus who upgraded women who were being downcast. Let's go with the Jesus who recognized that women were the last at the cross. Women funded the Jesus movement. Women were the first at the empty tomb and the first to tell the good news that Jesus is alive and well. Now, if Jesus loved women, what's your problem? Now, I'm real glad to see my brothers up, because brothers, we all know that the bottom line is we got here through a woman. Brothers all know we've been loved by a woman. Brothers all know every time I uphold a woman, I'm upholding myself. You can't be secure in your manhood and hold down sisters. I'm sick of that. But Gina Stewart, watch this. God is something else. You don't be messing with God's children. Do y'all know them National Baptist white Jesus in blackface preachers? They took Gina's sermon off their Facebook page. But enough folk had grabbed it, put it on other platforms, and the sermon went viral. Oh, y'all not shouting. Folk can take you off and God can blow you up. Is there anybody here who knows you ain't gotta worry about what other folk do to you? You just let God use you and God will bless you. I love this because that's what happened. The writer is in prison. His word goes viral. And now he says in chapter 4, watch this. I therefore encourage you to walk worthy of the calling that is on your life. The call to ministry is not, watch this, solely for those who are elevated on pedestals in pulpits. God has a calling on your life. God is up to something in the world and wants to get it done through you. God says you ain't got to be a preacher in a pulpit to have a calling on your life. God says, I've got a calling on you. I made you for a purpose. I called you, and since I've called you, I need you to get off the sidelines and get in the game. Oh, my God. And y'all do know we need to get in the game, because this game has huge stakes right now. The game is so huge because death-dealing forces preside over the policies of the strongest empire in the world that claims that it is about democracy, but it is promoting a massacre over in Gaza. And this country has the nerve to stand against the will of the nations of color. Have y'all not start to put this together? The nations of color, thank you, South Africa, for taking a stand against the genocide going on in Gaza. Thank you to those countries of color, whereas it's the white countries, it's the former colonizers who have engaged in settler colonialism, who are against calling for a ceasefire in Gaza. After all, colonizers always do what colonizers do and stand with colonizers. I see what's going on here. Behind all of it is the sin of white supremacy. Behind all of it is the sin of a settler colonialism that has hurt this world. And my sisters and brothers, we need you in the game. We need you in the game. Watch this, because poverty, to quote the great James Forbes, is still a weapon of mass destruction. The vast majority of people in this world live on just $2 a day. Imagine trying to live on $2 a day. Poverty is still a weapon of mass destruction, while the upper 1% own more than the lower 95%. I'm simply trying to say poverty is still a weapon of mass destruction, and both political parties in this country never talk about poverty and poor people on their political platforms. We need you to get in the game, because our schools are diseducating our children with a curriculum that lacks cultural sensitivity and responsibility, because they're so busy trying to whitewash the curriculum that they will not deal with the history of this nation, the history of our world. And so Laurie Daniel Favor says, we get it. Whenever someone says, why don't we study white history? No, you don't want to study white history. You want to study white mythology, because that's exactly what you enjoy. You enjoy the white mythology of a nation whose founding fathers were honest, and George Washington chopped down the cherry tree, and Abraham Lincoln never told a lie. You like that kind of mythology. That's what our history has been built on. It's not history, it's mythology. And y'all, I'm simply trying to say that maybe every Sunday I ought to call it White Mythology Month and just give you all of the mythology that goes with whiteness that is in this country, that toxifies our theology. Let's have that White Mythology Month. Since you don't want to study black history, I'm going to give you some white mythology and tell the whole truth about what's going down. But y'all recognize we got too much love in us, because we recognize if you attacking and holding down other people, that ain't making you better. It doesn't make me better to tear somebody else down. I'm just simply saying we need an education system that tells the truth. We need an education system that does not build up some at the expense of others. I see y'all looking at me, you saying he's on one today. You got that right. I sure am on one today. And so we need us to get in the game, because the game is serious. Game is serious. Environmental racism is killing us. I've said often, white rich folk create pollution that poor black and brown folk inhale and die from. We got to get in the game. We got to get in the game. So how do we do it, Freddie Haynes? I'm glad you asked. Three and I'm out. Number one, the text says, I love this first piece. You're going to get in the game because I love this. You built for it. Okay, let me talk to y'all. You can get in the game. You built for it. You built for it. You built for it. You built for it. Because here's the deal. I remember when I'm wrestling with my call to preach, and it was like, I'm like, but I know me, God. Why would you call me? I can't. And God said, exactly. I can through your can't. Okay. I thought y'all were feeling me. I'm going to go talk to somebody else, because y'all missed the shout right there. All of us, if we're honest with ourselves, have our insecurities, our self-doubt, our personal crises in faith. And sometimes it makes us doubt what we can do. And we believe more in what we can't do than what we can do. But God is so good. God says, oh no, I specialize in using folk who think they can't. And because they think they can't, that gives me room to insert my can in their can't. And so what you do is you do what you can, and God will handle what you can't. I'm preaching. Y'all just didn't get this thing. I'm trying to let you know, you ain't got to be insecure about your call. Just recognize it. First of all, your call is your call. It ain't somebody else's call, but God plants you to blossom where you are. So you ain't got to compete with nobody else. You ain't got to worry about somebody else having better skills than you and better gifts than you. You just do you, boo. And when you do you, the good news is God will do through you exceedingly abundantly above all you can ask or imagine. Do you? Because God gives us anointing and ability for our assignment. God capacitates us for our cause. God gives us what we need to get done, what needs to be done. God will set you up with the right people at the right time so you can have the right power to walk in the purpose that God has assigned you. Please hear me. There's a call on your life, but the good news is you're built for it. You're built for it. You're built for it. So last week, we shared that, please don't miss this, that Jesus goes to hell and back, gets a round-trip ticket, defeats the powers of injustice, oppression, and death. And the book lets us know, emerges with the spoils of victory, translates them into gifts to the body of Christ. Some apostles, those who were sent with the message to you. Some evangelists, those that give you good news in bad times. Prophets that foretell and speak truth to power, make you uncomfortable. Pastors, shepherds, and teachers who shepherd your soul, feed the sheep, fight the wolves. I'm talking about the gifts. Wait. And what do the gifts do? The gifts equip you. Okay. So you're built for it. You're built for it. Watch this. You're built for it because you already have a victorious Savior who has set stuff up. I told you, you set up for your come up, baby Baba. Oh, I'm looking at some of y'all. Y'all still stuck on come up. You ain't with the culture, so I got to help those of you who ain't with the culture. You know what come up is. Come up means, watch this, you on your way where you're going, and you're making such progress on your way where you're going that folk look at you and say, you on the come up. You are, watch this, successful, but not as successful as you're gonna be, but you ain't where you were, but you're not where you're going, and as a consequence, folk look at you and they say, you on the come up. Why y'all not shouting yet? Is there anybody here who can say, you just told my story? I'm not where I was, but I ain't where I'm going. I'm on the come up, and I came by to preach and let you know you've been set up for your come up. Set up by a victory that you already have, and then God connects you, watch this, with a body, a community, please don't miss this, that equips you. Oh my God, I love the word equip. We got some biblical scholars in here, especially Will G, and she knows this better than I, so I'm going to try to break it down. So equip in Greek, used in four contexts. I gave you two last week. Resetting broken bones. So trauma from being broken means trauma don't have the last word. You can get reset and stronger in your broken spots. That was a shout. And then repair torn nets, fishing nets that get ripped apart in the midst of serving. Let me tell you something. Let me I'm gonna do this one more time, y'all. When you make up your mind to work for Jesus, it's in the work that you get ripped apart. Because serving church folk, oh God, Jesus. Listen, one poet put it like this: to live above with saints we love, oh, that will be glory. But to live below with church folk I know, that's another story. Yeah. So watch this. So you get ripped in the process of serving, but you get equipped, you get mended back together. But you built for this, but there's two more contexts that mess me up. One is, oh, I love this. It was the context of outfitting a ship for voyage. Outfitting a ship for voyage. Now, I don't know nothing about that, so I did some homework because I knew y'all are smart, sophisticated, cultivated, consecrated, educated. So I did my homework and discovered that when they outfit a ship for voyage, it's mostly, I'm going to shout you, interior work. It ain't talking about all the external stuff you see. It's the internal stuff. It's the interior stuff. Because if a ship is going to sail and leave harbor, it's going to come into stuff that will require it to having superior interior resources to deal with those stressful exterior forces. Preach, Freddie. I'm doing the best I can. Okay, I got to pull Lauryn Hill one more time from the culture. How you gonna win? I got some culture folk in the house. When you ain't right within, because when you're right on the inside, and let me just say, whatever else I've discovered, I want to have a faith that strengthens me on the inside. Because when I leave here on Sunday to go to hell on Monday, I need to have something on the inside. It's on the inside that keeps me going. When folk cuss me out and I want to cuss them out back and slap the hell out of them, it's what's on the inside. What is this that won't let me hold my, what is this? It's on the inside. And so what I pray we do, we outfit you, we give you superior interior resources, so when you go out there you can handle them external forces. You gotta have it. I gotta go on. It's not just outfitting a ship for voyage, but it also preparing an army for battle. Let me go to another Baptist preacher who didn't get much shine as a preacher, but she sure preached. Fannie Lou Hamer. That Fannie Lou was something. Y'all see, Fannie Lou was classic sister. Classic sister. I love watching her testimony before the Democratic Judiciary Committee in Atlantic City, 1964. She walks up with a huge black purse. Real black woman like. Real black woman like. I mean, the girl was cold. She walks up with this purse and then she sits down. LBJ is scared to death. Because LBJ knows that she's about to go in. And y'all, she goes in. LBJ calls a press conference about nothing. And of course, all the cameras go to LBJ. But there was enough cameras with Fannie Lou that even when LBJ was done, folk came back to Fannie Lou. And Fannie Lou was speaking truth to power. Fannie Lou, watch this. They tried to give the Mississippi Freedom Party two seats when they had brought 18 people. Listen to Fannie Lou's classic response. Fannie Lou says when they offered her two seats, she said, "We ain't want no two seats. All of us tired." How you gonna give us two seats when all of us came here? All of us tired of second-class citizenship. And y'all, Fannie Lou did that. Read her life. Her life is just absolutely amazing. But Fannie Lou was built for it. She was equipped. What happened? Fannie Lou, I believe the year, Danielle, was 1963. She goes to a meeting sponsored by the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. And during this meeting, it's a mass meeting. James Bevel is up speaking, and Bevel is talking about their rights as a people. It resonates with Fannie Lou. First of all, y'all not shouting. I got to give you more context. Fannie Lou is the granddaughter of formerly enslaved. She is the daughter of a sharecropper. She is a sharecropper herself. She's in Mississippi that in a terrorizing way would enforce second-class citizenship on black people. But when Fannie Lou Hamer heard James Bevel speak, when she heard Stokely speak, when she heard Diane Nash speak, all of a sudden, Fannie Lou said, "That's who I am. I'm a first-class citizen." And before you know it, Fannie Lou, my sisters and brothers, goes goes to Charleston, South Carolina, where she is mentored by September Clark. She comes in contact with Ella Baker, and before you know it, Fannie Lou begins to turn Mississippi upside down. She leaves Charleston, goes back to Mississippi, gets savagely beaten, but she had already been given what she needed internally to withstand the hell she had to deal with externally. And that's all I'm trying to say, that when you come here, we ought to be preparing you for battle, not just with what you have on the inside, but knowing you got to go outside. And when you go outside, you go outside putting on the whole armor of God. You go outside with the shield of faith, the breastplate of righteousness. You go outside with the helmet of salvation, the sword of truth, the word of God. You go outside because you know it's a battle out there. Ah, but since it's a battle, you already know in this world you shall have tribulation. But be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. You already know if God is with you, who can be against you? You built for this. You built for this. Oh, please know this, y'all. Whatever ministry God has called you to, you built for it. You built for it. You built for it. How do I do this? I can go a number of ways with this. Let me go this way, because this is a good one. I was picked up, got an Uber, and I decided to do the highest class Uber because they were coming first, and so I got the highest class Uber. I am picked up, watch this, in a Porsche electric car. Porsche electric car, that thing picked me up. I got in, I'm digging the scene with my preacher lean. Woo woo. Oh, don't hate, celebrate. One day you can participate. I'm in this Porsche, and so you know me. I'm introvert. I don't be talking to people, but I'd ask brother, I said, man, how you like your Porsche? He said, oh man, this is fire. All I have to do, watch this, all I have to do is power it up at the power station, and I'm good to go. He said, I got a power station at the house. And so every night, I power it up. And once it's powered up, all I do is get in and drive. It's good to go because it's been powered up. It spent time, here's your shout, at the power station. And because it spent time at the power station, it's good to go. Every church, when it's doing the right thing, ought to be a power station. So when you pull up here on Sunday morning, all you got to do is plug in. And if you get connected, I guess y'all not shouting. I'm going to shout by myself. Every now and then, I just plug into the power station. I'm plugged in. All things work together for good to those that love God and are called according to God's purposes. I'm plugged in, y'all. Be anxious for nothing, but by everything, with prayer and supper. I'm plugged in, y'all. The Bible says, even the you shall faint and be weary. Young men shall fall, but they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles, run and not get weary, walk and not faint. Anybody plugged in? You built for it. You built for it. Now that you are built for it, watch this. Put in the work. Put in the work. Text says, it blows my mind. Text says, watch this. It says you built for it. Put in the work. Put in the work. He says, you're equipped for the work of ministry. That got me. God knows it's cool to have a good job. But beyond a good job, You better have a life's work. I think y'all feel me, because a job will give you assets, but your life's work will make you an asset. A job will pay the bills, but your life's work will make you a blessing. A job will give you some cash, but your life's work will connect you to a cause. A job will give you some dividends, but your life's work will give you direction. I am preaching this thing. Go ahead, Freddie Haynes. I'm trying to let you know it's essential that you discover, discern your life's work, because your life's work, watch this, for the work of ministry, 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 ministry. The word ministry has to do with waiting on tables.
Right.
Waiting on tables. So you go to a restaurant, served by a waitress, waiter, their responsibility is people, to make sure that people are served.
Right.
Hey, tell you this, but ministry is about people.
Right.
It's about serving people.
Right.
It's about waiting on people. I know it ain't easy.
Right. It's worth it.
But that's what Jesus did. Dr. Sandy F. Ray, one of the greatest preachers of all time, your Morehouse man, on the board at Bishop College, Sandy F. Ray preached my daddy's funeral. And Sandy Ray has a sermon in a book entitled Journeying Through a Jungle. And the sermon is called, watch this, Sis D, it's called The Testimony of a Towel. Testimony of a towel. It kills me. In the testimony of a towel, he says that Jesus is in the midst of a crisis. The political authorities and the religious authorities have gotten together and decided to take him out. And because the gathering clouds are about to unleash a furious thunderstorm of treachery, injustice, and oppression, Jesus is now trying to make sure his followers understand what the kingdom is about. The book lets us know, according to Sandy Ray, that all of a sudden, two of his disciples come and say, yo, G, here's what we need. You're about to come into your kingdom. Why don't you hook us up? We're cousins. And so since we're cousins, there ought to be some nepotism in the kingdom. Man, so here's what you do when you get to your throne. Why don't you hook us up? You the plug, give us a seat, one on your left and one on your right. If you hook us up like that, everything would be copacetic. Jesus says, no, that ain't how this kingdom thing is gonna run. Martin King said it ain't given by favoritism but by fitness. And so as a consequence, watch what happens. Jesus escorts his disciples into this upper room, and look what John, I believe it's chapter 13, says that Jesus, knowing where he had come from, Jesus knowing where he was going and knowing who he was, then ungirded his robe, took a towel and assumed the posture of a servant and began to wash the funky feet of his fickle disciples. Y'all miss your shout right there. Jesus took a towel. Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus, our celestial Savior, who came through 40 and two generations to save us. Jesus, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Jesus, I guess y'all don't know him, Adam's Redeemer, Cain's Vindicator, Abraham's Promise, Noah's Ark, Joseph's Dream, David's Music, Solomon's Wisdom. Jesus took a towel and began to wash the feet of his disciples. Now, here's what messed me up. Pastor, it messed me up because he's washing the feet of people. One gonna betray him. One's gonna deny him. Others gonna desert him. Will, you know what messed me up? I was wondering where any women getting their feet washed, because they the only ones who are gonna be there for him. This messed me up.
He's washing and serving the feet of folk who would do him dirty. But God is so good, God says, if folk you serve do you dirty, I'll raise up folk you don't serve who will be there for you when other... Freddie Haynes, you better preach that thing. I'm trying to let you know God is so good. He's using a towel to wash the feet of funky, fickle disciples. I like that word, funky, don't you? Yeah. Funkin' for Jamaica. Y'all ever heard that? Funkin' for Jamaica. Jamaica funk, that's what it is. Got it. Okay. That ain't got nothing to do with my sermon. I'm sorry. So he's washing their funky feet, their fickle disciples. And the text lets us know, he says, this is what the kingdom is about. It's about taking a towel. Sandy Ray said, y'all are looking for a title. The kingdom is about a towel. If you're not careful, you're going to be so concerned about a title and what folk call you, what they do for you, that you miss out on the fact that God ain't concerned about your title. God wants to know, did you have a towel? God wants to know who you helped. God wants to know who you served. God wants to know whose life is better because of you. Quit tripping over titles and get you a towel. All right, I'm done. Here it is. So one, you built for it. Put in the work. Get you a towel. Finally, watch this. Put in the work. You built for it because you down for the cause. Man, this messed me up. He said, we're equipped. And I forgot to deal with saints. I'll do that next time. Equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ.
Right.
Now, this came to me in prayer. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Yeah. I had just run into this super bad sister, Kelly Brown Douglas, and I was thanking her for all of her work and all this stuff. And so I went back and reread The Black Christ, Kelly Brown Douglas. And the more I read that thing and then connected it with this passage, I'm about to wipe you out and I'm done. Is that this text says we're to build up the body of Christ. So here it is. We're to add value to the body of Christ.
Right.
We're to add value
right.
to. We're to build up, help in the construction of the body of Christ. If we are adding value to the body of Christ, evidently we must be doing what Christ did when he was in his body.
Right.
I guess you don't know what Christ did when he was in his body. In his body, Christ gave first class status to women who were treated second class. That's for my black Baptist preacher. In his body, Christ was one who took a two-piece and five biscuits and fed those who were food insecure. What did he do in his body? In his body, he broke through barriers and engaged in civil disobedience to bring healing to those who were broken. What did Christ do in his body? Jesus would touch the untouchable. What would Christ do in his body? Jesus would heal those who had what? Pre-existing conditions and made sure that they were not charged for it. What did Christ do in his body? In his body, Jesus spent time healing the sick, raising the dead, restoring eyesight to those who were blind. What did Christ do in his body? He majored to those in ministry, to those on the margins. If we are going to build up the body of Christ, then maybe we ought to be doing what Christ did when Christ was in his body. When's the last time you reached out to those who were down and out? When's the last time you built up someone who had been torn down? When's the last time you allowed God's power to use your privilege for those who were underprivileged? That's what Christ did in his body. I guess y'all didn't get that. Shout me, Freddie Haynes. I'll be glad to. The Bible says in Matthew chapter chapter 4, he's in the wilderness after fasting 40 days, 40 nights. Here comes the devil. The devil says, if you the Son of God, turn the stones into hot water cornbread. Jesus says, it is written, you shall not live by bread alone, but by the word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. But then 10 chapters later, fast forward, and you'll discover in chapter 14, he's in the wilderness, but this time there's a multitude. And the disciples said, we better send them home. He said, no, we're going to feed them because they're food insecure. But all we have is a 2-piece and 5 biscuits. That's all I need. And he takes that and uses his power to feed those who were hungry. Wait, he did not use his power to feed himself. He used his power to feed other people. God gave you power not to take care of you, but to help those who are helpless. Build up the body of Christ. But you can't do it unless you get back in the game. Watch this. I'm done. Terrell Davis. That's where I left y'all, huh? Terrell Davis, 1998 Super Bowl. Takes himself out of the game. Sits out the second quarter. Because every now and then, it's all right to sit out a quarter. Every now and then, it's all right to say, you know what? I need a break till I get my own self healed. Every now and then, it's all right to take time out so you can pull yourself back together. But you don't take time out to stay out. You take time out to get refueled. And when you get refueled, you get healed. And when you get healed, you get strengthened. And when you get strengthened, you get empowered to get back in the game. The second half, here comes Terrell Davis. He rushes for 157 yards, becomes the MVP of the game. And the Broncos won the 1998 Super Bowl. Watch this. It began as a nightmare, a migraine from hell, but because he called timeout, but he said, I was determined to not let the migraine have the last word on me. May I just say right now, don't you let your personal struggle have the last word on you. Trauma can't have the last word on you. Suffering can't have the last word on you. Go ahead and get back in the game. Get back in the game because Jesus said, behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst to bulls. So be wise as serpent, but harmless as a dove. Get back in the game. After all, you the salt of the earth. Get back in the game. After all, you the light of the world. Get back in the game because God has a calling on your life. Get back in the game because the world won't get no better unless you do what you're supposed to do. I gotta call Teddy Pendergrass. Wake up, everybody. No more sleeping in bed. No more backward thinking. Time for thinking ahead. The world won't get no better if we just let it be. We gotta change this world, just you and me. Y'all don't like R&B? Let me give you old school Baptist. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Everywhere I go, I'm gonna let it shine. If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or song, if I can show somebody he's traveling wrong, then my living will not be in vain. You've been set up for your come up. Now let's step up. Listen, I want to do this right quick. Because somebody came to church, somebody's online, you're watching. Bottom line is, you need this Savior who will outfit you for voyage, who will get you straight inside. Only God can do that. You need a Savior who can outfit you, give you superior interior resources for this thing called life. If you're here, if you're online, and you don't have a connection with Christ and the Creator. Yeah. You're living life disconnected. Anything disconnected is in dysfunction. And so if you're disconnected, Today is reconnection time. You've come to the power station to get powered up. And so if you're here, if you're online and you're not saved, if you're here online and you're not in right relationship with God through Jesus Christ, you're in the right place. It's the right time. If you're online, you call that number, 469-498-0210. Or email us and join us at friendshipwest.org. If you're in the house, it's sure enough good to see you. We'd love to have you in the family. And so if you're here and you're not saved, you're not in right relationship, you know that dysfunction characterizes your life because of disconnection, today's your day to get that thing right. Here's what you do. Stand up. Step out of the aisle you're in. Come on down front and give your life to Jesus Christ. You see, we have some wonderful ministers down front, our disciple ministry. They're waiting on you. They're going to privately minister to you. I love you. I love you. Bless your heart. I bless you. I bless you. I bless you. Thank God. Listen, what a witness. What a powerful witness that is right there. Because if he can get wheeled down, can you walk down? Come on, give your life to Christ. Come on, do it right now. Bless your heart. I see you coming. Bless your heart. Preacher, I need connection with Christ. I want to plug into the power station. I want to do it right now. If that's you, stand up, step out. Come on down. Give your life to Jesus Christ. Do it right now. Do it right now. Bless your heart. Bless your heart. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love it. I love it. You're here. And your thing is, okay, I got that part right, but I feel God leading me to join church. I'd like to plug into this power station called Friendship West. If that's you, you're in the right place. It's the right time. Here's what you do. Stand up, step out, come on down and join church. If you're here, you don't have a church home. You're here. You feel led to join church. Today's a good day to join church. It's a good day. Because listen, you got to have that power station. So stand up, step out, come on down. Preacher, I used to go to church. I stopped going. I'm ready to get back in church. Bless your heart. I'm ready to get back in church. I'm going to get back in church. And so today's your day. Come on, let's get back in church. Stand up, step out, come on down, and let's get back in. Preacher, here's my deal. I just moved to Dallas-Fort Worth from another area. Got a church home, but it's back there. But now I live here. I work here. I go to school here. I just ain't got no church home here. Today's a good day to have a church home here. We'd love to have you. We'd love to serve as your pastor. Stand up, step out, come on down, and let's do that thing, okay? So wherever you are, whoever you are, God is speaking. Bible says the day you hear God's voice, harden not your heart. That inner impulse you say, go up there, that's God talking. I see you. I see you. I see you. Here's what we're going to do. We're getting ready to stand, and when we stand, we're going to be ministered to in song. I want you to let the words of the song speak to you. As the words of the song minister to you, I'm going to ask you to stand up with us. And if you know it's time to give your life to Christ, if you know it's time to join church, stand up with us. Step out of the aisle you're in. Come on, let's do it today. Let's get that straight today. Stand up, step out. I see y'all coming. Come on down. Give your life to Christ. Join church. Look at them. They're coming, y'all. They're coming. I love that. I love it. I love it. I love it. So here it is. Shall we stand? And won't you come right now? Come on. Get outfitted for your voyage. Come on. Do it right now. Give your life to Christ. Join church. Hallelujah. You feel so, so close. Listen, listen. I was really trying to stop because I want to do something else, but the Spirit won't let me stop because the Spirit said, you're out there and you know who you are. You know who you are. And listen, God is speaking. God is speaking. I know the devil's messing with you because the devil, Bible says, disguises himself as an angel of light. That means the stuff he's saying, it sounds good. It's excuses that really sound good. My pledge, we learned that excuses are tools used by incompetent individuals to build monuments of nothing. So if the excuse is you're going to build nothing, okay? And that's devil. Devil wants you to build nothing, lead a life of nothing. But here it is. God is talking. And I know you wrestling going back and forth. If you wrestling with God, make sure you lose. That's the only way you're going to win. So whatever is keeping you back, maybe you're saying, well, I'm waiting on God. God said, no, I'm waiting on you. Well, I'm waiting on somebody else. Well, what God said, maybe if you do what you're supposed to do, then they'll come next. What you're saying, well, I'll wait till next Sunday. It ain't even promised to you. You have right now. I hear you. I'm going to get myself together first. God says, so you're going to trust you to get you out of what you got you into. God said, no, I accept you right now as you are. And I'll come into your life as you are. But once I come into your life, you ain't going to stay the way you are. So here it is. Here it is. Here it is. If you're here and you know it's time to get connected with Christ and your Creator. If you're here and you know it's time to join church, don't wait another second. Come on down. You're the reason the Spirit said I got to wait. There you go. There you go. Somebody else. Y'all sing that again, okay? Sing that again. They still coming. Come on, come on. Give your life to Christ. Join him. Do it right now.
I'm available to you. My will, I give to you. I'll do what you say to me, Lord. Just go some miles away and enable me to stay. Oh, my courage is in me, and I am available.
Extend this another further, and that is, y'all hold on, I'm gonna pray for you real soon, okay? But God's Spirit is speaking and saying, okay, there's some folk out here, you in church, you in Christ, but you're on the sidelines. You're not in the game. You have yet to either discover what your call is, discern what your call is, or walk in your call. And there's a call on your life. And listen. I'm here to outfit you for voyage. I'm here to prepare you for battle. This is your power station. Listen, it's serious out there. It's serious out there. And we need folk in the game. And so God, watch this. Bless your heart. Bless your heart. I love it. Bless your heart. So God led me to say, okay, we're going to have one more call to the altar. And I like what y'all doing, okay? I like what y'all doing. And that is, my storage is empty. I'm available to you. I need some folk who are saying, God, I'm available. Here I am. I'm available. I don't know what my call is, but I'm willing to learn. I'm willing to be taught. And I want that. Or you're saying, yeah, God's been messing with me. God's been tugging on me for quite some time. I just have yet to say yes. And I'd like to today be prayed for. I'd like today to have someone pray over me so I can begin the process of not only discovering my call, but living out my call. This altar is open to you. And I want you, if you are in the house, you already joined church, you already gave your life to Christ, but today you're saying, yeah, I want to go ahead and get in the game. Come to this altar, okay? Come to the altar, not the seats, the altar. And we're going to pray for you, okay? I got pastors on staff who are going to pray for you. I got ministers of the gospel who are going to pray for you. Come to this altar and let's talk to God about the call that is on your life. There's a call on your life. There's a purpose. Do you know your purpose? Listen, don't settle for just having a job. You got to have a work. What's your life's work? What is your life's work? Here it is. Today, listen, I want this to be the year where you are walking in the calling that is on your life, where you are about the work that God has called you to do. So come on to this altar and let's talk to God. Let's talk to God. Come on, let's talk to God. Come on. I see y'all. Bless you. Yes.
To the depths of my soul. Yes, Lord.
From the bottom. God bless you. God bless you. To our new family members, welcome home. Welcome home to those of you who are saying, yes, Lord, hallelujah for you. Let me tell you. Let me tell you, this is going to be, this is, it's not just the day you were born, but the day you find out why you were born. And that's my prayer, that you find out why you were born and then live in that power for the rest of your life, okay? Let's pray. God, thank you so much for the privilege of new life in Christ. Thank you for the privilege and the gift of a power station, a church. And I pray your blessings now upon these your children who have come to say yes to you. I pray your blessings upon these your children who have come to connect with Jesus and connect with your church. God bless them. God, in the name of Jesus Christ, fill them with your Holy Spirit. Order their lives in your word. Use us as their family to connect with them. Love on them. Disciple them. Build them up. That they, oh God, may be equipped. And as they are equipped, oh God, I pray that they will know they're built for the work. That they can put the work in. And that they are down for the cause. In Jesus' name. Now, God, I pray for these your children who are not just going to celebrate the day they were born, but the day they discover why they were born. God, in Jesus' name, bless them now. Order their steps in your word. In Jesus' name, reveal to them what it is you were up to in their lives. May they not just know who they are and whose they are, but may they know why they are. And so in the name of Jesus, go ahead, reveal, reveal, reveal. Give them discernment and wisdom. And as you do it, give them the faith to not only hear from you, but to walk in what you reveal their lives are to be about. And so bless them. Now, God, this is kind of scary, because now we're stepping out on faith, but we're going to step out on faith knowing that we're taking the step. Though we don't see the staircase, we're taking the step knowing that our hands are in your hands. And since our hands are in your hands, we know what we can do. We believe what you can do. So go ahead, have your way, have your way. You are the potter, we are the clay. Mold us and make us after your will. While we are waiting, yield it and still have your way. Have your way. Speak, Lord. Reveal. Equip. Empower. Encourage. In Jesus' name. Amen. And hallelujah. God bless you. 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 Those of you who have said yes and joined church, please go with our disciple ministry and our ministers of the gospel. They're going to take you to an area and privately minister to you. Please go with them. Welcome home, okay? Welcome home. God bless you. Welcome home. Come on, y'all. Let's celebrate our new family. Let's celebrate those who've discovered their why. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. Listen, it's offering time. It is offering time. Hallelujah. 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 God has been good to you, so God can be good through you. God gets blessings to us to get blessings, and because God wants to be a blessing through us. And so please now prepare to give in a way that, first of all, is obedient to God's word. God's word puts it real plain. Bring the whole tithe. That's a tenth off the top. Parenthetically, anybody saying, I want to put God first in my life, well, check your tithe record, because the Bible lets us know where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Kenneth Olmer says a tithe is a sign that God is first in your life. It's a sign that, watch this, not only is God first in your life, but that God is owner, and you see yourself as steward, as manager, and you want to be used by God to be a blessing in the world around you. Y'all know Friendship West is about that, being a blessing life in the community, specializing in ministry to those who are the least of these, trying to do all we can to upgrade them. Please help us to do that, okay? We minister year round. We don't just wait till Thanksgiving and Christmas. We do it all year long. And so please help us to do that, because ministry that is extensive is expensive. But you also know we about that justice life. That means we are confronting systems and structures that are unjust. And y'all, it costs to do that. So please, speaking of cost. So yesterday, I got a text from my wonderful COO, broke my heart. She said, you know, this fight we have against this truck yard, it is against a truck yard. They're trying to build a truck yard down there and bring environmental junk to us. Now, why don't they build it on their side of town? They don't even live over here, but they want to build it over here. Build it next to your church, because they love to tell me, we go to church, we pray everyone. What? I don't know what God you're praying to. Did your God tell you to build trash on our side of town? So we're fighting them. Oh, God, speaking of it. So Wednesday, y'all pray. Because Wednesday in the morning, I had to testify in court against them. Okay, Wednesday we go to court. We got to testify on Wednesday morning. It's going to be a crazy week, so I really need your prayers because I'm stressing, okay? So Wednesday morning we go to court. Wednesday night is vision night. And then Thursday and Friday, Rainbow Push stuff. So it's going to be quite a week. So Wednesday, we got to go to court. Now, y'all do know with court comes attorney fees. And then, so Vita was breaking down the money we've been spending. And y'all, I'm not going to read the text because it hurt my feelings. But Vita said, this is hurting the church. I know it's necessary, but it's hurting us financially. And so I'm just being real upfront and honest with y'all that I kind of need us to do our part, okay? Because we are taking this on not just for ourselves, but for our community. Because listen, since we've come to this community, since we bought this property, let me tell you all that has happened. We bought this property at the end of, 99, 2000, something like that. And after we bought the property, then I'm a part of the Pastors Coalition, and we built Unity Estates, the first middle-income housing development built on this side of town in decades. And Friendship West was a part of that. We got a street named after us over there in Unity Estates, okay? And then, so we bought this, Unity Estates goes up, and then we build. Next thing you know, Exxon does a nice gas station down there. Wow, nice gas station on our side of town, full service. And then Target, a whole mall. All of that has come since we've come. And now you want to put a truck yard here? There's something. Did you, when I was growing up there, what doesn't go in this picture? Something doesn't go in this picture. And so it cost us. And then they're always trying. I'm going to tell you what happened. I'm going to tell you everything that happened. I'll tell y'all after. Okay, but let me tell a little bit of what happened. So then I met with a dude. He said this. He said, well, we will have the trucks come down Polk Street to Wheatland and never come down toward the church. So you think I'm just looking out for my church? My church is the community. I'm gonna tell y'all more later on, but right now, just know that I'm not going for that. What is an 18 wheelers coming down the street across from an apartment complex? Across from where seniors live in single family homes, across from Carter High School. We want 18 wheelers coming? That's a tragedy waiting to happen. So we fighting, but it cost us to fight. And I'm asking y'all, help us pay for the fight, okay? Help us. I'm asking you today, I'm asking you. I'm gonna give an extra $100, Vita, over what I was going to give, because I was going to give already, but I'm going to give an extra $100. And if y'all join me, over what you're going to give, okay? That's what we're going to give toward this fight. Because I don't want Vita to text me next Saturday and say, you're hurting the church. Because that hurt my feelings. That hurt my feelings so bad. Do y'all want me to have hurt feelings? Okay, I see you didn't shake your head. So you don't care that my feelings are hurting? All right, I'm messing with you. So please, y'all, please. On a serious tip, please give your best, okay? Give your best. Let's pray. God, thank you for the privilege of giving you the gifts now so that through them we can fight the good fight. Through them we can serve those who are underprivileged. Through them we can be a gift to the community. Through them lives can be changed. A community can be impacted. Even a world turned upside down. Bless gift, but also bless each giver. Bless each giver in such a way that they will experience afresh your word. It says it's more blessed to give than it is to receive. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're getting ready to go. I just want to give you this. Don't forget to get your tickets for the biggest gospel show in a church that I think has ever been held. Marvin Sapp and Yolanda Adams and who else? Donnie McClurkin and who? Hezekiah Walker too? All four in one spot on March 1st. Y'all, it's folk coming. Do y'all remember Dr. Kizmikia Corbett? She's the one who found the vaccine. Kizmikia lives on another part of the country. She teaches at Harvard. She called me, she says, I'm coming and I'm bringing six folk with me. And today Al Wash is going to other churches selling tickets. Do not let them buy up tickets here. And you didn't get your seat? Okay, so make sure you get your tickets. Please do that. All right, God bless you. I love y'all so much. I think that's everything, right? Is that everything? Is that good, Vita? All right, Vita, I'm doing my best, okay? All right, God bless you. God keep y'all. Y'all have an amazing week. We good, Deb? All right, I love y'all. Please have a blessed week. Come here. Vision night is Wednesday night. It's going to be an amazing night. Plus, you want to come here about court, all right? Because I go to court on Wednesday morning, and I'm going to be dressed like my boy in suits. I'm going to be Harvey. Walk off in there. I'm Harvey. You see suits? Y'all pray for me, okay? The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord cause God's face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of God's countenance upon you and grant you peace. Go now in the power of God's Holy Spirit. Listen, you've been set up for your come up. Let's get in the game and step up in Jesus' name. Peace. Love y'all.
We praise God for this impactful experience and for your joining us during it. Check us out on social media and please like, share, and subscribe at Friendship West. Then go to www.friendshipwest.org to find out more about this marvelous movement. Find out how to participate through sharing your prayers, sharing your offerings or monetary gifts, or sharing and investing your time volunteering with this difference-making ministry. For you who are viewing as visitors, you can share that you were here by taking time to text FWVIZ to the number 28950. For those who want to, this time that you are visiting to be the last time that you are a visitor, you can become part of our fabulous family of faith, either by calling 469-498-0210 or by emailing joinus@friendshipwest.org with your first name, your last name, and your cell number. Either way, we look forward to hearing from you. We're so excited that you are here. Until next time, blessings on you.
West Baptist Church.